Welcome to the Yoga International Yoga Day. This pandemic has made us understand the importance of breathing, importance of meditation, importance of developing your immune system, importance of healthy eating, and many more things, though it was very bad experience for us otherwise, but it has made us understand that the old culture, Indian culture, was really good, and the people were trained so that they can face any epidemic. Today is International Yoga Day. Yoga is derived from the main Sanskrit word yuj, which means unite or join. And 21st June, we all know, is the longest day in the Northern Hemisphere. So this day has been chosen as International Yoga Day, and I'm very happy. It is the very next day of our Founders Day of the college. Yesterday we celebrated 60th Founders Day, Foundation Day, which we celebrate it as Founders Day, commemorating the dedicated services done by then visionaries, philanthropists, our management, as well as other people who were associated for starting this college immediately after Goa's liberation. Today's Yoga Day is special because we all have realized, the full world has realized, the importance of yoga now. And at the backdrop of this pandemic, definitely we should know the importance of meditation and yoga and breathing exercises. Very, very important. And it has proved that the people who are exercising all this, they have overcome the corona disease, even if they were infected. An apt personality for today's talk on meditation and yoga is ex-principal of our S.S. Dempo College of Commerce and Economics, Sri Shashikant Sirdesai. Besides being a very good administrator, a very good teacher also, right from 1971, he was faculty for undergraduate and postgraduate students. He was visiting faculty for Goa University, of course, in yoga meditation for the various orientation courses and such type of courses. 40 seminars he has conducted on yoga, stress management. He was a coordinator of UGC at Goa University. Also a member of Indian Yoga Association. And for this, the training he received was from the oldest yoga institute, that is Kaivalya Dham. He has completed intensive course in yoga at that institute, which is a renowned institute and the oldest institute in the world. And his expertise, that is why, is in yoga meditation and of course breathing. So today I take pleasure in inviting him and hosting him as the chief guest as well as the speaker on this auspicious occasion. I welcome all the staff who are sitting here in our Swami Vivekananda Hall, as well as those students and teachers who are joined online for this session. Happy Yoga Day for you all. Happy healthy life, and let us fight Corona together with our oldest technique of yoga and meditation and take it to the world to prove that India can teach everybody spiritualism, can teach yoga, and teach also the world that without any investing in any of the instruments, still you can remain healthy and safe. Thank you all, and let us listen to Sri Shashikant Sardesa.
Good morning and namaskar to you. At the outset, let me thank the principal, Dr. Vrinda Burkar, and vice principal, Manjiri Barve. Just, I think it was 1 week ago, I requested Manjiri and expressed my desire to share my little knowledge of yoga and meditation for the staff. And she had no option, and she told me, you can go ahead after consulting the principal. So thank you very much for that. And let me tell you, soon after that, I got the 2 invitations. One from the Mallikarjun College and the second one from Sopti, Organization for Women. So today on webinars. So yesterday was the first webinar of my life. So I'm, as you know very well, I'm used to, you know, interacting with the students for last 40 years, you can say 34 years, nearly 35 years in Commerce College. And I was a guest lecturer here for about 4 years, biotechnology, entrepreneurship development. So thank you very much. Now the topic that I'm going to deal with has 2 parts. Yoga and meditation. No doubt, meditation is integral part of yoga. But today what is happening, you must have observed also that the importance of meditation has been increasing. It has been enhancing since 1967. I'll share that particular history later on. But don't forget, meditation is a part and parcel of yoga. So first, in brief, I'll be giving you idea about the yoga. As your principal has pointed out, yoga, this particular term, has been derived from yuj, that is Sanskrit root. Yuj means to unite, to yoke, to integrate, to merge. This is the meaning of yoga. You get me, no? The meaning is this. Yoga means the union, in short. Now, what is the interpretation of this particular term, yoga? The interpretation is very simple, but the interpretation is spiritual. Yoga means merging individual consciousness or individual soul, integrating with the cosmic soul, that is yoga. Generally, yoga is equated with different type of exercises. No, we can go above it and find out the real meaning of yoga. That is integrating with the God. That's the meaning of yoga. There is a beautiful shloka. Let me see, I can recall it in Hatha Pradipika. Hatha Pradipika is one of the oldest book on Hatha Yoga. I'm going to explain to you what is the Hatha and what is Yoga, Hatha Yoga. Let me recall that particular slope. I love that, but I don't know to what extent my memory is going to support me. Vapu krishitvam vadane prasannata nadasputatvam nayane sunirmale arogita bindu jayo agni dipadam nadi vishuddhi hatasiddhi lakshanam. How many of you could get the feel? What is the meaning of this particular sloka? I'll translate it in English. Slim body, joyous face, sonorous voice, clarity in voice, sparkling eyes, positive good health, virility, exuberance of radiance and vitality, and the purity of the nervous system are few of the physical characteristics endowed by the practice of yoga. You will wonder that after practicing yoga for 40 years, what I could achieve is only slim body, no? Nothing else. So friends, let us switch over to different concepts now. You must have heard about Hatha Yoga, no? All of you. Please raise your hands. Hatha Yoga, never heard about Hatha Yoga? Okay, it's a very common term. You know, Hatha Yoga means, Ha stands for the sun. Ha stands for the sun. Tha stands for the moon. So according to yogic philosophy, we are governed, the right part of the body, including your right nostril, is governed by the sun. Am I making it clear? And the left side, including the left nostril, is governed by the moon. So Hatha Yoga is a yoga of the body. So Hatha Yoga includes postures, pranayam, mudra, bandha, whatever that builds your body, that nurtures your body, that is Hatha Yoga. So Hatha Yoga is a yoga of the body. And there is another term, again you must have heard of this particular term, Raj Yoga. Have you heard this? Raj Yoga. So what is Raj Yoga? There are two interpretations of Raj Yoga. The first interpretation, it was practiced by kings. So it is known as Raj Yoga. And secondly, it's a royal path to get connected with the God. So Raj Yoga is the yoga of the mind. And Hatha Yoga is the yoga of the body. That is the difference. Coming to the next term, that is Ashtanga Yoga. Have you heard about it? And do you remember a name associated? Any problem? Okay. It's okay. Okay. Ashtanga Yoga. What is the meaning of Ashtanga? Ashtanga. Yes. Eight limbs. That's right. So it was sent or sage Patanjali. Have you heard this name? Patanjali. Researchers are not sure about his when he was born. But what they say, he was born after Buddha. Buddha's century, I think it's the 5th century BC, no? And in case of Patanjali, he was born, they say, 2nd or 3rd century. It's debatable again. But he was born before Christ. after Buddha. He was a sage, and what he did, the most important thing, he systematized the knowledge of yoga. Patanjali, sage Patanjali, systematized the knowledge of yoga and wrote a book known as Patanjali Yoga Sutra for himself. As in economics, Adam Smith did the same thing, no? Systematized the knowledge of economics. Patanjali did the same in 2nd or 3rd century BC. So it is called Ashtanga Yoga. Ashtanga Yoga means there are 8 steps. First one, I'm not going to discuss about it because we need a time for the later session. There is a meditation. Yam, Niyam, you know it. Yam, Niyam, Asan, Pranayam, Pratyahar, Dharana, Dhyan, Samadhi. 8 steps. What is Yam? Like Satya, Ahimsa. They call it restraints. Niyam means culture, Shauj, Swadhyaya, etc. Third one, Asanas. All of you are familiar with Asanas. You must have performed also, no? Many of you. Yogic Asanas. Sukham Sthiram Asana. Body postures. Then Pranayam. What is Pranayam? It's composed of 2 words, no? Pran and Ayam. Pran is not breath or air. Pran stands for vital energy. All of us, we have vital energy. That is known as pran. The regulation of pran, expansion of pran, is known as pranayam. Okay. What is the next one? Pratyahar. Pratyahar stands for withdrawal of the senses. Generally, you know, we are attracted towards different objects, no? So in pratyahar, what we do? You withdraw. That's for pratyahar. Then dharana. Dharana stands for concentration. Dhyan. Dhyan stands for meditation. And the last one? What is the last one? Samadhi. What is samadhi? Super conscious state. So this is called Ashtanga Yoga. Now the next part of yoga, most of us, we try to equate yoga with asanas and pranayam, no? That has been my experience, most of us. But yoga it goes beyond that. So what are the different components of yoga? And just I'll spell out the important part of it. I'm not going to discuss in detail. Yoga includes obviously asanas, no? All are familiar with asanas. And what is the importance of asanas? Again, I'll be very brief. What is the importance of asanas? It increases your flexibility. No? It increases your flexibility and strengthens your muscles. You can get connected with the God provided you have a sound body. So asanas try to build your body. Coming to the second one, pranayam. Just now explained the term, so you know about it. Then we have shat kriya. Have you heard about yogic shat kriya? Yogic shat kriya. Shat kriya means 6. Kriya means here purification process. What is the meaning of kriya? Purification. Cleansing of the body. In short, it means cleansing of the body. So what are shat kriya? Just I'll name them. We're not going to discuss in detail because we don't have that much time. Okay, you must be familiar with neti, jala neti. Can you recall that particular instrument? A small instrument is there, no? You put that particular water. So neti is one of the kriya. Then basti. Basti is nothing but a colon cleansing. No, you know enema, okay? It's a yogic enema. In short, it is yogic enema. So basti, Then we have Neti. Then we have Dhauti. Have you heard about Dhauti? Dhauti means intestinal cleansing. One is called Vastra Dhauti. You swallow big cloth, I think around 16 or 70 meters long. I did it long back. I don't think it's possible to do it right now. And we have Jala Dhauti. Or if we call it Vaman Dhauti. You drink a lot of water and afterwards you throw it out. It's a cleansing that generally I do, but nowadays I have not done that. Neti I regularly do. Then we have Tratak. What is Tratak? Cleansing of your eyes. You look at the flame, gazing at the flame, and you improve your vision. So that's called Tratak. Then we have Kapalbhati. Kapalbhati. What is Kapalbhati? It is, though it is termed as a Kriya, it is considered as a Pranayama also. I'm not going to demonstrate, but many of you must be familiar with the concept, no? Kapalbhati. Then we have Nauli. That is the abdominal recti. You move it. So these are known as cleansing processes. Altogether, there are 8 cleansing processes. Okay. Then we have in yoga, mudras. Have you heard about it? Mudras. Mudras are hand symbols. I'll show you one mudra. Can you do it? Please try, see. This is the index finger, no? Pardon? Oh yes, that's a good suggestion. Okay, see here. Okay, this is called a very important mudra, they say. This is known as Mruta Sanjeevani Mudra. Now, what is the importance? This is advisable for the heart patients. If you do it regularly, you will be able to. You are very young people, that's a different thing. But those who have crossed their 60s, you can keep away the cardiovascular problems. Mruta Sanjeevani Mudra. So we have many mudras. Just I wanted to show it. Just I wanted to demonstrate this. Then there are bandha. Bandha means different locks. And those different locks, they improve the quality of your glands. Then we have Yoga Nidra. All of you know about Shavasana? This is extended Shavasana. Can last for 10 minutes, sometimes 15 minutes, for 20 minutes also. Yoga Nidra, English translation is psychic sleep. It's a very, very relaxing. Then we have yogic eye exercises. See the scope of yoga. Different type of eye exercises. And then we have meditation. The ultimate of yoga is meditation, and we are going to deal with meditation. So these are the different components of yoga. Yoga should not be confined to only postures and pranayama, no? It goes beyond that. But just I wanted to give you the outline. Now we can switch over to meditation. Is it okay? Scientists studied doctor recommend it, and millions people, they practice it because meditation works. I'll repeat it again. Scientists studied doctors recommend it. Million and million people, they practice it because meditation works. What is meditation? There are many definitions. I'm not going to confuse you. with those definitions, but I love one definition. I like it most because it's very simple. Meditation has only one meaning, that is going beyond the mind and becoming witness to it, and there lies the mystery of life. I'll repeat it. Meditation has only one meaning, that is going beyond the mind and becoming witness to it, and there lies the mystery of life. So what do you understand by this? So meditation is basically related to your mind. It's going beyond the mind. Now what is mind? All of us, we have the similar mind. No, whether you are Russian or American or Japanese, mind is the same. And what are the characteristics of mind? What are the characteristics of mind? Restlessness. Mind is restless, no? Though you are sitting here, I don't know about your mind. It must be wandering, no? It's very restless all the time. And there is a turbulent flow of thoughts. And every day, do you know? All of us invite more than 50 to 60,000 thoughts that bombard your mind. It's a very restless. Another characteristic of mind, very difficult to control. No? Don't you think? Very difficult to control mind. And there is a reference in Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna tells the Lord, Lord, it's very difficult to control the mind. And you know what is the reply? What is the response from the Lord? He doesn't say, you don't know, Arjun, you are idiot. You don't know how to control the mind. He doesn't say, he says, yes. I remember the term that he uses the term Mahabhava. Mahabhava means mighty arm, Arjun. Yes, he says. It's difficult to control the mind, but you can control the mind with the help of two things. The first, abhyasena, and the second one, vairagyena. Abhyas. Abhyas means regular practice. And the second one, vairagyena. What is vairag? Renunciation. But which is not possible for the householders, no? So what is possible for us? Abhyas. Right? You need not go to the Himalayas. It's a vairagya. So see, the mind is our, so try to understand the mind, it's a revolting also. So while dealing with the mind, as I already told you, that the mind is related with the thoughts, no? There's a continuous flow of thoughts. Now the question arises that how you are going to form the mind? I'm asking you a question, a simple question. Is it possible to separate waves from the sea? Is it possible to separate fragrance from the flower? Is it possible to separate moonlight from the moon? No. So similarly, it's very difficult to separate thoughts from the mind. So what is the way out? To stop the thoughts. When you are able to destroy the thoughts, there is no mind. Mind is there because there are thoughts. If there are no thoughts, there is no mind. So in meditation, what we try to do that, we try to stop the thoughts. And then we see what is mind. Okay, or sometimes we call it mindfulness or awareness. Am I clear about this? So meditation deals with your mind. It's a very interesting fact that, you know, how many students are there for psychology or philosophy? Okay. As you must have heard about Freud, no? Sigmund Freud, founder of psychiatry, and all his followers. What they say, that as your body is susceptible to, as your body is susceptible to different diseases, your mind is also susceptible to different diseases. You know it. Okay. What Indian philosophy says, that's very interesting. Indian philosophy says, mind is itself disease. Mind is itself disease and meditation is the cure. Now we are going to switch over to the different techniques of meditation. Now it's not possible to discuss in detail about those techniques. So I'll be very brief about it. So there are basically two techniques that I'm going to share with you. Okay. So before that, what we generally do, that's called observation of thoughts. We call it observation of thoughts. What is that observation of thoughts? What we are going to do, it's a different technique now. You are going to just observe your thoughts. You are not going to produce them. You are not going to generate them. Nor you are going to prevent them. You are getting my point? What you are going to do, you are going to be a dispassionate observer of your thoughts. Very interesting, no? You are going to observe as if you are a different entity. So you are going to watch your mind. That's what we are going to do for 1 or 2 minutes. Shall we do that? You understood the technique? What you are going to do? Just observe your thoughts. Don't produce them. And another thing, don't get involved with them. No involvement, not entanglement. Just you observe. And I'll give you a simple example. Imagine that you are sitting on a bank of a river, okay? And watch the turbulent flow of the water, okay? Just watch it. But supposing you take deep into it, you jump into the water, then you become the part of the water. So whenever you embrace different thoughts, that affects you, know? So what we are going to do now, we are not going to take a dip into the water. You are just going to observe your thoughts. Okay, shall we do it for 1 or 2 minutes? All of you. Please close your eyes. Please close your eyes. Just 1 or 2 minutes. And observe your thoughts. Okay, it's a very symbolic. Tell me what you experienced. The mind goes on wandering, no? From one thought to another, from one place to another place, from one incident to another incident, and from past memories to the future plans, no? All the time. But when you try to watch it, mind becomes aware. And thought process gets, it slows down. Have you observed that? If you do it regularly, you will realize that when the mind knows that somebody is watching it, mind becomes calm. It's, you know, your mind, that's what our ancient philosophy says, mind is equated with monkey. You know about monkey, you must have seen monkey also. Not just simple monkey who is drunk. You can imagine, no? Adhis Markat Tatun Madhya Pyala. That's what there is a saying in Marathi. So mind is like a monkey who is drunk and who is bitten by the scorpion and possessed by the ghost. So that type of mind all of us we have. So this is the beginning that we, so you give a training to your mind to slow down. Now I'm going to share with you two techniques of meditation. I'm going to share with you two techniques of meditation. The first technique is called TM. Have you heard about it? TM, that's a short form. TM stands for Transcendental Meditation. And who was the author? Again, I'll be very brief about it. Yes, Maharishi Mahesh. So you take a lot of interest in this yoga, meditation, and ancient Indian culture. So Maharishi Mahesh, he was a science graduate. He did his MSc. I'm telling you the story of 1967. And what he did, he heavily borrowed. Have you heard about Maharishi Mahesh? He has become a hero in the Western world. Okay. So what he did, he heavily borrowed from Indian scriptures and put everything in a capsule and called it TM, that is Transcendental Meditation. And luckily, you know, he got the followers. A musical group, Beatles. Have you heard about Beatles? So all of them, they became converts. And he shot to the new publicity. Particularly in Europe and America, he became very, very popular. This particular technique, it's a technique, please remember. This technique became very popular. And Americans embraced it. But you know, Americans, they want the proof, no? They want the scientific proof. So there was one doctor, Dr. Benson. He belonged to Howard University. So he conducted different type of tests and he came out with the startling conclusions. Are you getting my point? And with the help of latest scientific tools, he could prove many things that we are going to deal with later on. Okay. What I wanted to tell you, that they tested and then only they accepted. The moment they accepted, we also accepted. That's what we always do, no? What is happening in USA is going to happen in India day after tomorrow. In every respect, you may call it a cultural assault, but that is happening. And you can't stop it also, unfortunately. So the first technique that I'm going to share with is called TM. It's a very, very simple technique. Okay? Simple instructions are there. What we are going to do, just for 2 minutes we are going to do it. You are going to close your eyes. You are going to sit properly. Properly in a sense. Your backbone, your neck and your head in the same line. Right now you cannot perform asana. Generally it is performed in Padmasana or Vajrasana or Sukhasana. But here demonstration is not possible. Okay. So try to understand the shortcomings also. So what we are going to do, we are going to mentally chant Om. Okay, that is the sense of TM. You take a particular word, a particular monosyllable, and you just chant it. The best way is to chant Om mentally. Yeah? Now my Christian friends, they can think of Jesus. Okay. They can think of Jesus. And Muslims, any Muslim here? No, they can think of Crescent. But generally, Om has been universally accepted. So Om is no more a religious symbol. It is a cosmic symbol. Because it has been accepted by the West particularly. Because Om has no backward linkage. Om doesn't have forward linkage. Okay. Am I making myself clear? So the next step, you are going to close your eyes, sit properly. Okay. And just mentally chant Om for 1 or 2 minutes. And what is the purpose of this? As you know it, what we are going to do it? We are going to stop the thoughts, no? That's a meditation. Already I told you. Meditation, going beyond the mind or going beyond the thoughts. That is meditation. Shall we do it for 1 or 2 minutes? So please close your eyes. And Om here stands for, try to understand. think that you are not the body, think that you are not the mind, think that you are only pure consciousness. Okay. Are you following my point? Don't think of your body. Don't identify with your body. Don't identify with your mind. Think you are pure consciousness. And obviously, this is going to make you thoughtless. Come on, we'll do it for 1 or 2 minutes. Try to understand the gist of it. Okay, that's okay. So you understood the soul of it. Now I'm going to share with you the second technique of meditation known as meditation on breath. Meditation on breath. It has been derived from, have you heard about, I think you must have heard about it, Vipassana. Vipassana meditation. Have you undergone? You get Pari, they've got a headquarters there. So the second technique that I'm going to share with you is called meditation on breath, and it has been derived from Vipassana. Vipassana is a Buddhist meditation, and it was popularized by Goenkaji. It is no more. So that meditation is meditation on breath. Now all of us, we are breathing, no? Is there anybody who has stopped breathing? No. Right? But we are not aware of our breath, no? Are we aware? We are not aware. So in this meditation, what we do, you are aware of your breathing. When there is inhalation, you are aware of it, and there is exhalation. So what you do? You observe your breathing. In other words, you observe your breath. It's called meditation on breath. When you breathe in, experience it. And when you breathe out, again you experience it. There's a meditation on breath. Now, the same meditation has been improved to some extent, and they call it Zen meditation. Generally practiced in China, Japan. Zen. This term has been derived from Dhyan only. Zen meditation. In Zen meditation, what you do, you count. 1 for inhalation, 2 for exhalation. Okay. So you have many cycles. You go up to 10. Then you can have 5 rounds or 10 rounds or 15 rounds. Shall we do it for again 1 or 2 minutes? It's just symbolic. Just to give you idea about the gist of that particular meditation. So please observe your breathing. Please sit properly. Your backbone, your neck, your head in the same line. And just observe your breathing. So when you breathe in, even find out the temperature. And when you breathe out, it becomes a little bit hot also. Have you observed that? Because it gets processed inside. Okay, so we'll do it again for 1 or 2 minutes. Close your eyes, please. Okay, that's all. And there is an improved version of the same meditation. What you do in this particular meditation, you just observe exhalation. Just observe your exhalation. There's an improved version of the same meditation. Okay. Now with this background, now we are going to deal with what are the benefits of meditation. What are the different meditations? As already I told you that in USA, particularly in USA, they conducted different surveys, right? And they found out the claims put by Maharishi Mahesh, all claims, they were accepted. So what were their findings? If you regularly practice meditation, so this is the first one, is physiological side. Then the second one is called cognitive side. And third one related to how you can apply it in practice. Okay, or you can say spiritual side, you can call it. So coming to the first one, physiological. They found out that your heart rate goes down. Okay, this is, they found it out, that means with the help of test conducted by Dr. Benson from Howard University. They found out it drops. What is the normal rate? It's 72, you know? It goes down. And what is the implication of it? When it goes down, it reduces the wear and tear of your cardiovascular system, right? So BP goes down. BP also goes down. So the treatment that is recommended, prescribed by the doctor for BP patient, hypertensive patient, you know what is the treatment? The meditation and relaxation technique also. So they found it out. Then coming to the next part, they found out that regular meditation can erase the blocks. You must have heard about the blocks, no? Many people, they have different blocks in arteries. So they found out that if you meditate regularly, those blocks disappear. I had been to Mount Abu. Have you heard about Brahma Kumaris? And there was a conference on preventive cardiology. I've got a friend who is a cardiologist. He took me. And I attended that particular conference for 3 days. So there was one session. And they announced that now Dilwale, they are going to express their experiences. Now you will be also surprised. Who are Dilwales? You know who are Dilwales? Dilwales means heart patients. They are known as Dilwale there. So they were called, they were around 15, and they narrated their experiences, thrilling experiences, spine-chilling experiences. After doing meditation for 6 months, those blocks disappeared. So they call their meditation Raj Yoga meditation, which I could not share with you because we don't have that much time. It's called Raj Yoga meditation. Anybody who has visited Mount Abu, Brahma Kumaris, it's about Howard Vice Principal, have you heard about it? Oh, Brahman. If you get the opportunity to visit it, because you know what is the khasiyat of that particular Brahma Kumaris? The entire show is managed by ladies only. And there is no chaos, there is no confusion at all. Everything is systematic and organized. See the Nari Shakti, no? Women's power. Everything is very smooth. We stayed there for 3 days and a lot of hospitality. While living also, they gave us the food packet. So we should not starve. So much organized. Now, what is the peculiarity of that particular institute? They treat heart patient in this particular manner. Okay? I visited it, I experienced it. So next thing, what are the other physiological benefits? As I already told you, have you heard about Dr. Dean Ornish. Anybody? Dean Ornish. Dr. Dean Ornish was cardiologist and physician to President of USA Bill Clinton. You have heard about Bill Clinton, no? You know about his young heart. So Dr. Ornish, I read his book. The name of the book is Dean Ornish Program for Reversing the Heart Disease. Contains 500 pages, but I'm going to tell you the summary within 4 words. He says, the first, your cardiovascular health very much depends upon your diet. Okay? And he prescribes, being American, he prescribes vegetarian diet. You know, Americans, they're non-veg. First. The second one, regular exercises. And he recommends walk. 30 minutes walk. It is a must. Particularly those who have crossed their 50s. If you are young, no problem. But walking is very important exercise. Second. Third one is called opening up. You know what is opening up? What we do generally? What we do generally? We don't open up, no? And particularly during COVID times, this problem has been aggravated, no? So when you open up, you try to reduce your stress. So opening up. So talk to somebody. It may not be possible for you to talk, to share everything with your wife, but you can have your friends, relatives. Talk to somebody that you can do, no? Talk to your friends. And the fourth one, so what was the first one? What was the first one? Diet, exercise, any type of exercise, but he prefers walking. Third one, opening up, and the fourth one, meditation. He learned meditation and he introduced it. He realized the importance of meditation, Dr. Dean Ornish. And he says, I remember a very important statement. He says, heart disease is not the disease of the heart, it is the disease of the mind. What he says? Heart disease is not the disease of the heart, it is the disease of the mind. So always try to remain happy. Meditation makes you happy. Okay. Coming to the second part, cognitive. They found out that regular meditation improves academic excellence. So particularly for students, they can resort to or they can bank on meditation. And in case of workers, teachers, it increases the job satisfaction. You enjoy the job. So there is less burnout. There is less frustration. You're getting my point? Cognitive increases your memory, improves your concentration. So these are cognitive benefits of meditation. And coming to the third part, which is altogether different and which you can apply in practice. First question that I wanted to ask you, are you at peace with yourself? Are you at peace with yourself? You need not tell me. But try to respond to it in your mind only. Are you at peace with yourself? The most important relationship, do you know? Can you identify the most important relationship? Your relationship with yourself. Not your relationship with your wife or your father or your mother or with your friend. Your relationship with yourself. So meditation improves that. I don't know how many of you have seen this particular movie, 9211, taxi number 9211. Yes? least one person is there. Yeah, and Nana Patekar is there. He's a disturbed man. The same problem. He is not at peace with himself. So if you meditate regularly, you will realize that your relationship with yourself goes on improving. I still remember when I was taking a lecture at Academic Staff College, orientation course, all were lecturers. So I asked this particular question. And there was only one lady who stood and told me that I'm happy. Then I asked, yes, she told me that she has been practicing meditation for the last 10 years. And I could see that on her face. Next question that I want to ask you, again, it's related to the first one only. We talk about the happiness, no? All are in search of happiness, no? Is there anybody who doesn't want happiness? No, you don't find that. But our happiness is conditional, no? The concept of happiness is conditional. What is that? What is the meaning of conditional? Oh, when I'll get married, I'll be happy. When you cross your 30s, you think of that, no? I'll be very happy when I'll get married. When I'll buy a car, I'll be very happy. When I'll have children, I'll be very happy. When I'll become the principal, I'll be very happy. But that is not correct. A principal knows his or her ideals, okay? All right? But you forget that you are the fountain of happiness. Happiness lies within yourself. So when I asked this particular question, I still remember somebody said, no, there was one student, not a student, he was a lecturer. He raised his hand and he told me, you know, somebody said, I'll be very happy when I'll get married. I think he was around 35. Okay, so he was worried about the loneliness perhaps. But you know, there was a counter answer. There was another person, he raised his hand and said, sir, I'll be very happy if I get the divorce. I'm telling you the fact, huh? See, so our happiness ultimately depends upon external factors, no? Not the internal factors. But basically meditation tells you, you are the happiness. Why you are searching happiness? You do it. And then you realize, oh. Then I always feel that we live at three different levels. The first level is called nature. You're a student of psychology, no? Or you're a lecturer. Philosophy, oh, that's a part of you. Three levels. The first level is called nature. We are animals, you know that, no? All of us are animals basically. Developed animals, but animals. So Freud calls it id. Yes, instinctive drives. Okay, we'll take a simple example. When you become angry, what are the different manifestations? The first one, expression, no? When two workers fight, they fight with blows, no? That's expression of anger. So sometimes when educated people, they can't control their temper. I've seen that. I know the story of a college when the principals slapped one pupil. I won't name the college, I won't name the principal. Okay? Yes, he did it. That means he could not. That means at that point of time, he became animal. So there is expression. Okay? The second one is culture. It's a culture. And Freud calls it superego. He calls it superego. Culture means you are governed by social norms all the time. So principal is very angry, but doesn't say anything. So actually what happens? You suppress your anger, no? First one is expression. The second one is suppression. You try to suppress it. That also creates a lot of problems, no? But the third way, not to become angry at all, no? And you learn that through meditation. You don't become angry. I'll give my own example. In the past, I used to lose my temper. Later on, I realized, when I started meditating, I realized, not that you can totally eradicate your anger, it's not possible. But you can reduce the you know, the intensity of it. Supposing there are 10 trigger points. Trigger point means the point that provoke you to become angry. So out of 10, in the beginning, supposing you get angry for 8 times, later on, it goes on reducing. I know that everybody can't become Christ or Buddha or Guru Nanak. There is that particular divinity, but you can certainly walk on this particular path. And then you realize, oh, you are so calm. So meditation teaches you. And meditation teaches you another important thing, that in our life, there are only situations, there are no problems. There are only situations, may make them problems. What we do, we take a magnifying glass and look at the situation and make it problem. So that is a disproportionate magnification of the situation is a problem. So later on you realize, oh, these are different situations. You make it problem, you lose your energy, you invite stress, you invite anxiety and all the things. So, last part, technique. I'm sorry, not the technique, but frequently asked question, how to do it, when to do it, just simple questions. First one, either morning or evening, depending upon your convenience. Just 10 minutes. Huh? In the beginning, we'll find it difficult also, 10 minutes. Then the posture, Padmasana, or Sukhasana or Vajrasana. Please have a separate room if it is possible and tell your friends, I'm sorry, tell your family member not to disturb. Take them into confidence and you can tell your wife also, or you can tell your spouse to cooperate. Okay. And if possible, go to the Miramar beach. So you need an open space also, you will enjoy that. Nature always supports meditation. Anything else about it? Where, when? I think I've answered those frequently asked questions. So thank you very much for listening and God bless you.
So it was a nice session on meditation and yoga. A very apt one on today's auspicious day, that is Yoga Day. I hope you all make the best use of his experience. Enough meditation courses are there at present online. Only thing that you have to make up your mind first, that we will meditate and be away from what he has said, that is the biggest enemy of the human being, that is anger. So I wish all a healthy, happy year to come. Let us face the pandemic by doing meditation, doing yoga, eating healthy, and having a very good sleep. Thank you all for joining us on this meeting.